Hello, my friends. I am Brother Martin. I was born August 29, 1937, on a farm in southern Minnesota near a small village by the name of Sleepy Eye. I was the fifth member of the family. There were nine of us, so I have four siblings older than me and four younger than me. My father was a farmer, and that's all I ever wanted to become, a farmer. My father passed away when I started grade 7, and I was a troublemaker to my mother even before that, and of course even more so after that. When I finished grade 8, my mother wanted me to go to high school. It was not required, but I kept saying, no, I will not go to school. I absolutely hated school. So I kept saying no, and she kept insisting that I go until mid-August. I finally said, okay, I will go, but I'll quit after 1 month if I don't like it. In high school, I all of a sudden had, there were 56 of us. So I had classmates finally, and I fell in love with high school. To the point where my mother wanted me to quit. My two oldest siblings were brothers. One of them was drafted into the army, and then my mother wanted me to quit so that I could help my other brother work the farm, and I refused to quit. That's how much I liked high school. In my third year, my buddy asked me to take chemistry with him, hearing that it's fun, explosions and everything, so I did. Well, I fell in love with chemistry, so much so that I decided I won't be a farmer, I want to be a teacher. And I really wanted to, even then, wanted to present the subject to other kids and have them appreciate it as much as I did at that time. While I was going to high school, I stayed with my cousins because we lived about 12 miles, which is about 20 kilometers from this town. So I got a job at school, after school, cleaning the building. And I got to know the Franciscan sisters in a very different way than you would ordinarily know your regular teachers. So all of a sudden it dawned on me, I want to be a teacher, these women are teachers. I wonder if there's something like that for men. So I finally asked one of the sisters, and he said, yes, we have brothers. First time I've heard that term. We have Franciscan brothers, we have Dominican brothers, Benedictine brothers, Jesuit brothers. She asked me, what do you want to do? I said, I want to teach like you guys. And I said, I probably would join Franciscans. And she says, oh, heavens no. I said, why? I says, these orders have priests. You will never teach. You will only be a slave to the priests. So you join the Christian Brothers. These sisters happened to run a small college for girls in the same little town where the brothers had a college for boys. So I wrote a letter to the brothers. I didn't know a single name. I just, dear brothers, I want to join you guys. What do I do? And so it ended up, I became a brother, and I'm still at it 62 years later. You know, living with other people can be difficult. When you live with men, it's probably even more so. But when we're trained in our formation, we are trained in also how to get along well with others. So now I'm living with men who have the same inspiration, the same ideas as I have. We pray together, we socialize together, we eat together. We do the same kind of work. So we have this support, and it's difficult to describe to others when one has this kind of support. That's probably the best thing about our life, is that constant support that you get from all of these men that you live with. And it makes no difference whether you're living with 10 guys or 20 guys or two guys, and I've done it. I've done everything. I started living with 125 at one time. When I first started teaching, we had 44. For many years, there were just two of us. Now here at De La Salle, we're living with 20, 30 sometimes. So that's the best part of the brother's life. Our basic schedule, we get up quite early. We have prayers at 6, followed by Mass and meditation. And then we're off, all of us are off to our various jobs. Lunchtime depends on where you are, at the schools where you're working. You get home, you relax, you might read the paper, you might socialize a bit or just rest. We have evening prayers around 6 o'clock, followed by dinner. And then after dinner, most of us, unless we have nothing to do the next day, we'll go to our rooms, get ready for the next day's work and so forth, or go to sleep early. In the house, we also have jobs, various jobs. So right now, they've appointed me as the sub-director of the house. Our director is Brother Dennis, and whenever he's not around, I have to make all the decisions. So I'm not sure who the brothers prefer asking, Brother Dennis or me, but it looks like they would prefer me. So we'll see what happens as time goes on. I'm also the econome, which means I'm in charge of the food in the house, the purchasing and what kind of food the brothers want and so forth. We really have lay people who do all the purchasing, but we do tell them we need more of this or we need more of that. And then finally, I'm also in charge of the brothers' studies, foreign brothers. This year, I think there are going to be about 11 of them. So I've been helping them with their English pronunciation, their grammar, and now they want me to overlook their course of studies, making sure they're on time with what they're doing, they're not dropping out of classes, they're getting good grades and so forth, and reporting back to their various provincials in their home countries. Teaching chemistry is probably the most fun I've ever had. Doing things for kids, surprising them. I don't know if I can use the term shocking, but certainly waking them up with different explosions and different things. I had a demonstration almost every day that had something to do with the topic I was teaching. So they were always on their toes about what I do. Taking a very difficult subject and making it clear and simple to students, and when their eyes light up and they realize they understand the difficult thing, that is a joy, that it's difficult to explain to someone else. You achieve something with those students. But besides chemistry or science, there's so much more that you do with kids. You teach them about life and what's good and what's not good and how you should live and what you should do and what you not should do. That comes automatically with any of the classes that you teach. That's the best part of teaching. When I look at the schools where I taught, I've taught in four schools. My first school was LaSalle School in Chicago, an all-boys school. Then I was moved to one of our schools in Minnesota, St. Paul, Minnesota. It was an all-boys school. After a few years, we merged with a girls' school, so it became co-ed. And I stayed at this school for several decades. That school is still very much a part of me, and I have so many alumni, former students from this school who still stay in contact with me. Then I came to Manila and I taught at DLSU and then at Sobel and now also at Araneta, although I'm not teaching at either of these two places. The one thing you see, particularly at Sobel, is the LaSallian spirit. I don't think you can find this kind of spirit in any other school, whether it's in the States or whether it's here in the Philippines. Sobel just shines with this LaSallian spirit that all of the teachers seem to have. You know, as I go around the different LaSalle schools in the Philippines, and I say, I do some work at Sobel. Yes, we hear about Sobel. Sobel is known by all of these other schools, and it's known for excellence, and that's what we have here at Sobel. This kind of excellence, however, is also found in many of our schools. You know, when the brothers start something, they may start with something which isn't very good, but give them a few years' time, it becomes excellent. The brothers do something to these schools, and our lay partners just chime in and do most of the work for us. So I look at particularly DASMA, for instance. When we obtained DASMA and the hospital and the medical school, it wasn't known very well at all. And now it's a sort of amazing what the brothers have done with that complex out there. When I came to Sobel in the 90s, it was a fairly new school. It was less than 20 years old. And in its growing years, and now I come back and I see the transformation, it's almost startling and it's sort of amazing. So it is that real LaSallian spirit, friendliness, helping one another. Everyone's trying to do a better job than someone else, and that excellence is shown, particularly at this school. I do exercise, and whenever we don't have a school day, I will walk anywhere from 8 to 10 kilometers, usually along Rojas Boulevard, through the Luneta Park and back. How are you? And when we don't, like our summer break, I do it every day. And if the weather is bad, of course, that ends it. I usually start walking at 5:30 in the morning, when it's not quite as hot as it would be at 8 o'clock in the morning or later on. So I stay in shape with my exercise. When I returned to the States in the year 2000, I didn't expect to retire overnight. I had not planned that. So what do I do? So there's a mother of some students that I had that suggested I do some sewing. And I thought she was crazy, but she said, let's do some, she first of all was, I don't know what you call it, needlework and yarn and this plastic thing. She said, make a little cover on a Kleenex tissue box. So she showed me how to do it, and I really enjoyed it. And I told her, I said, I'm going to make a periodic table with this. So she had no idea what a periodic table was, so I had to describe it to her, and she thought I was crazy. No way can you do something like this using needlework. She said, why don't you try cross stitch? I had never heard of cross stitch. I said, what's that? We'll go to a knitting place, a hobby shop and find a simple cross stitch pattern for you. So we went. So she's looking at all these simple ones, and I see this beautiful one. She said, I found one for you. I said, I found the one that I'm going to do. She said, no, that's for experts. I said, that's the one I start with. And I did, and I loved it. Well, then I designed the periodic table, but I'm colorblind, so I had to get someone to help me with the colors. And I eventually got the periodic table stitched. It's about the size of a bed blanket. It's fairly large. So I still do cross stitching in my free time, whether it's on weekends or after school or sometimes in the evening. So I keep at it. Then while I was home, I decided to do family history. My father is one of 16 in his family, and my grandfather, there were four boys in that family. So I decided to do whatever information I can get on those generations up to the present. But as I was talking to the various relatives, do some research on ancestors. So I really got involved in that and started tracing my ancestors back to about the 1700s. I've written 5 books on these families. Some are very large. My own family comes to over 1,500 pages. And I'm still working at 3 books right now, although it's a little bit slower being over here in the Philippines. Outside of that, I read chemistry stuff on the internet, and I go around cheering up people, which part of my animator job, but I go out to DASMA, cheer up the handicapped retired brothers, stay weekends with them. Sometimes I join the young brothers on their outings, middle-aged brothers. So whatever age is, I'm that age. Okay. I don't know how many times people have asked me this question, so I should have an answer ready whenever they do, but it's always hard really to pick out a particular Filipino food that I really like. So I'm just going to mention the ones that I really like. I'm not sure which one is my favorite. So I like chicharron, lechon, bulalo, dinagun, balut. Everything that one shouldn't have, I guess. People say, you can't be eating all this unhealthy stuff. I says, yes, I realize that, but I have a theory on that if I eat chicharron repeatedly, my health will probably deteriorate in about 20 years' time. At that time, I'll be 100 years old, so who cares? I'm going to enjoy it all right now. As years go on and alumni come back and tell you what you did for them, what it means for them, that's the legacy I think that one will have. They will talk about their teacher that they liked. They will also talk about teachers they don't like, but that's quite a difference. I believe that these people, as they gather for their class reunions or whatever else, will talk about a person, and let's say in this case, talk about their chemistry teacher. That will be the legacy I'll have leave behind. And some of the things you hear now, I'm quite happy that it turned out as well as it did. Thank you. Well, let me answer that looking at myself or an individual person first and then a school. You know, I taught chemistry for 45 years. Now, I could have become an ordinary teacher, I suppose. After 2, 3, 4 times, I now know how to teach this lesson. I'll just teach it the same way every year, every year. If a person does that, you'll become a very dull, uninteresting teacher. Someone that won't inspire anyone, the kids won't learn a thing. And so I always made it my point that every year I have to prepare a new way of presenting things. The kids change from generation to generation, from year to year. And so if I present, I'm presenting a chemistry topic and I can see the kids are not understanding, it's your job now to change. How do you present that? And it's something a person has to work on. How do you change right in the middle of what you're doing? It comes with time, but it also comes with practice, and it comes with year dedication to the job you're doing. The same is true of a school. So Bell right now is standing on a pretty high pedestal, a school that's looked up to. Why? Because we have excellent programs. We have really outstanding teachers. We have teachers who've done amazing jobs internationally. They're recognized as such by the school and awarded as such. Hopefully, what they have done seeps down to all the others, that they will also start doing these kinds of excellent things and becoming outstanding members of the faculty. Now, we can't sit on our laurels. If that's all we're going to do and not improve from year to year, we will become stationary, we'll become just a normal school, and eventually we'll fade off and become a school that nobody even, it's just so bad. So our job is to, as well as we're doing things right now, everyone has to say, I've got to do even more. I've got to do even more. I've got to do even better. And also get many others to join us. And I'm always hoping that happens, not just at Zobel, at every one of our LaSalle schools around the world.